Let me begin by extending a very warm welcome to all of you to the 20th IAGRG meeting, which is IAGRG 2015, in celebration of the centenary year of gender relativity. We'd like to thank you all for making it here and for being here with us today for the next few days. I would like to inaugurate this session by inviting the director of RRI, Professor Ravi Subramanian, followed by the IAGRG president, Professor Ghanshyam Dase from IMSC, to come here and say a few words. Thank you.
Welcome to the Common Research Institute. We are, of course, very happy to have all of you here today in this meeting of people with a passion and with a mastery of gender relativity and gravitation. I would like to first of all express my appreciation and thanks to Sumati in particular for her energy in bringing this meeting to the Raman Institute, and to all of the local and scientific organizing committees and my colleagues here in this institute for having made this event happen. I would like to extend a special welcome to a few of you here who have a special place in the history of this institute and who have many friends here. Ramesh Narayan, welcome. Vishnu, welcome. Bala Iyer, of course, needs no welcome. Arun, if Arun is here, welcome home. I would like to extend a most special welcome to Jayant Nanikar. We are absolutely delighted that you are here. I have personally benefited from his advice over the years, including friendly advice to Lakshmi and me on bringing up children when he visited us in a remote, isolated dwelling in the middle of nowhere in country Australia. Thank you. So Jayant, you are a father figure for this community in many ways and will always be so. This year is indeed a special year for the association. It is 100 years since Einstein presented his complete theory of general relativity. And is it not amazing, at least to me it is, that in these 100 years, we have not moved on from the foundations set so long ago. We seem to have done no experiment that has failed GR. I can see that all of you have a good reason to celebrate. It's fitting that Sumati has organized a banquet tonight. Hope the food is good. So with Jayant here, I would like to recall a nice meeting that was organized some 2 decades ago here in Bangalore. I think it was in JNCSR. It was titled Discussion Meeting on Big Bang and Alternative Cosmologies. I don't know if some of you were there. It was an introduction to me in my formative years on the way science works. It was healthy for science that there was a standard model and there were alternatives, and a meeting did not shut the door on the alternatives. At the end of that meeting, there was a discussion session to come up with specific predictions of Big Bang cosmology, which were not expected in the alternatives, which, if disproved, would be accepted by the mainstream community as the end of the road for the standard theory. Paddy took up that challenge in that meeting. It was accepted that if future measurements of the CMB anisotropy spectrum did not yield the multiple peaks that were expected in the standard model, which were not expected in the alternatives, then standard Big Bang cosmology with its structure formation theory would have to yield to something new. That was to me a demonstration of a way that science works. So the question I have is, do we have a Jayant for the GR community in India? Welcome to our.
Uh, We have the IHERG president, Professor Ghanshyam Bhatti.
Thank you, Mr. Modi. On behalf of the IHERG Council and IHERG Association, let me welcome you all for this 28th meeting of the IHERG. I would like to begin by first thanking our host, which is Honorable Institute and Director Mr. Subramanian, for hosting this meeting here. Because we are always on the lookout for saying when the next meeting is going to be held. So when we learn that it's going to be at RRI, we are very happy that a nice place and nice, hospitable place meeting is being held. So thank you so much for it. Now let me say a few words about the association. The simplest way to do is to introduce you first to the website, which will give you all the information. Of course, I won't be willing for all of it. So just a few highlights. The association itself was started in 1969, so it's almost 46 years old now. Formally it was registered in 1983 as a society, but before that it was informally meeting. Nevertheless, the meetings of IHERG have been conducted quite regularly over 46 years, which itself is something to be proud of. It's not easy to maintain sustained activity over a very long period when different sets of people get in and continue it. So since 1985, it has been regularly every 2 years IHERG meetings are held. So there are principally two main activities. One is the International Conference on Gravitational Cosmology, which takes place every 4 years, and that began in 1987. 1987 was the first meeting of ICGC. Next is, that happens every 4 years. Another is the IHERG meeting, which is at a national level, and that happens every 2 years, and since 1985 the frequency has been maintained at regular intervals. The purpose of these meetings is, of course, international meeting is to allow the possibility of interacting for the local, within the country, community of relativists and cosmologists to interact with the international community. At a national level, it is a slightly different purpose in the sense its interactions there, but largely also within the community, within the country. There is wide range of expertise available as well as interest in the country, whether it's research institutes, universities, colleges and so on. So this provides an opportunity for people to intermingle and spread the interest in the subject. So these two meetings are the main activities. We also have recognitions of different kind of, in the form of different awards. One is Vidya Rai Chaudhary Endowment Award, and tomorrow we will hear from Professor Bala Iyer. So this happens every 2 years at the IHERG meetings. And since last time we have extended it to be taking place every year, so once it will be wherever the IHERG venue is, and once it will be anywhere else in the country which is organized. So now VR lectures are given every year. We also have the Best Thesis Award for thesis work done in gravitation cosmology related areas, which happens again, these are given every 2 years. And since last time we have introduced one more award for the young researchers, that is the NRCN Award. The information about the details of this is available on the website, so I will not give more details. A few other points is, after the website was started, roughly the number of members, because now it's much more easy for people to know about it as well as get information. Currently the membership stands to about over 400, and I think before the website of maybe about 300 or so. So on an average you get about 10-15 members, new members every year. In order to enhance and make this website a little more informative, we would like help and suggestions regarding this part, resources, where we are trying to organize various kinds of information which can be useful for the community as well as outsiders. Everything is open currently for everybody. So this is where we will need inputs and links. This is going to be basically links and not text, especially in publications, copyright things are there, so we will only give you links. So I would just like you to request to please go to the website, give us suggestions, volunteer to make it better. And there will also be a general body meeting tomorrow. So all of you are welcome for that, and please contribute to the discussions as well. So in these few words, let me hand over the session to Sumati again. Once again, I welcome you all and enjoy the meeting. Thank you.
Before we start this morning's session, I'd like to say a few words as chair of LOC. First, we had an overwhelming response to this meeting, very unprecedented. We had 215 people wanting to come to this meeting, and unfortunately, because of the size of the venue as well as the limited accommodation, we could only allow 100 to be registered. But we thank you all for those of you who've come here. We hope it's also going to be a memorable meeting. Let me begin by thanking the sponsors of this meeting. First is IUCA, and then IMSC, IISC for help with accommodation, IIA, and of course the funds of IGRG, and also the very generous support of RRI. We have a very, very nice an exciting meeting ahead of us, thanks to the Scientific Organizing Committee and the workshop chairs who put in a lot of effort. I'm sure that as you look through the program, you'll find that you wouldn't want to leave even after 2.5 days. I also wanted to give special thanks to those on the local organizing committee who've done a huge amount of work. To Devarshini Chakrabarti, who is here at RRI, who many of you have corresponded with. She's put in hours and hours of work over months, several months, and she's at the registration desk for those of you who have not met her yet. And of course to the IISC team, Bani Pratap, Tarun Deep Saini and Pratik Sharma, for making sure of accommodation in IISC. We're very grateful for that, because without that we would not have had this meeting. And of course, a very special thanks to the RRI team, Ramasubramaniam Ram, who has helped with the transportation, Srihari, who has got these beautiful folders out, done all the work for that, as well as taken care of all the catering arrangements. Manjunatha will help you with the transport, as well as IAGRG related activities here. And Jacob Rajan and Krishnamurti, who have done the IT support. In fact, today, for those talks which can be put on this computer here, we have a live streaming to the library box, thanks to them. And to students like Ankur Roy and Oman, who've been helping out a lot. Just a few logistics. I mean, this morning it seems that we're not full, but based on our information until yesterday, we would have been a completely packed audience here for the registered participants alone. And for those of you who are not registered, it's a request that if this talk is being live streamed, and it depends on whether the speaker is using a laptop or using the main computer. Unfortunately, we can't stream using the laptop, but if they're using this computer here, then, and you find that there's no space in this auditorium, please make sure that that the registered participants have place, and you can go and view this talk in the live broadcast of the talk in the library block. And please switch off the ringers on your mobile phones. And thank you once again for being here, and hope you have a very memorable meeting. So we can begin, in fact, a bit early, which is, I suppose, okay. So the first session, and the chair of the first session is Shiv Sethi.
Sorry, 15 minutes, sir.
Yeah. I think there's no issue, right?
So, welcome everyone, and start the first session. And the first talk is by Mr. Ramesh Narayan on generality and astrophysics of black holes.
Yeah.
So,
okay. So thank you very much for the invitation to come to this conference. And I want to tell the director, you know, I started my life after PhD here at RRI, as you probably know, right? Many, many years ago. In fact, I first occupied an office in this building, corner downstairs. Durandhar was there, he was my roommate, and Rajaram Nityananda and Vishnu. And yeah, so Vivekananda and various others, we started there. Then after a while, we moved to the library block. That's where, you know, we had a really fantastic group of really smart people. You know, Vishu was the, you know, the big man there. Vishu Bala was there, Rajaram Nityananda, Bhandari, and Shukre. Very smart people. And in a sense, that's where I first learned astrophysics. And certainly, first time I heard about black holes, because, you know, my background was not in astrophysics. So I came and learned it all here. And now to come and give a talk on black holes here, this is a real pleasure. It's a topic that I really picked up much later. I learned all the basics here, but never worked on it. Only about 20 years ago, at Harvard, I started getting interested in black holes. And what I'm going to try and tell you today is what astrophysics can do for general relativity, and in particular for our understanding of black holes. This is mic okay? It seems to be echoing a little bit. Okay, good. So let me start by, you know, we're celebrating the centenary of GR, but it's also the centenary of black holes. Because as you know, within weeks after Einstein came up with and actually formally presented GR, Schwarzschild discovered an exact solution of the equations. It's a nonlinear theory, as you know. Exact solutions are rare, and Einstein himself never found an exact solution. He only had approximations. So Schwarzschild found this spherically symmetric solution, which was a surprise to Einstein, because he had tried to solve the same problem. I think he used Cartesian coordinates. And Schwarzschild just showed that, you know, the spherical coordinates, it works beautifully. So the solution was around, and as far as I know, people didn't immediately know what it meant, because it's got so many interesting properties. Took a few decades, but now we know what it is. Schwarzschild's solution is a black hole, and that was the first black hole solution 100 years ago. So we are celebrating centenary of black holes. Just to remind everyone, you know, what we're talking about a classical black hole here. Quantum mechanical effects will come in some of the later talks. So within classical GR, this black hole is when matter is crushed by gravity, and the matter is unable to provide enough pressure to support itself. And this is something that's inevitable under appropriate conditions. And what happens is, whatever mass is present in this object, it all gets squeezed down into a singularity. Zero radius, infinite density, but finite mass. And it doesn't have a surface. Instead, what you have is this event horizon. A pseudo surface, virtual surface, which separates what's inside from the outside. And again, as everyone knows, the speciality of the surface is that it goes a one-way street. Things can fall in, but anything that's gone inside the horizon cannot communicate back. And that's a fantastic feature of the black hole solution. It's a consequence of general relativity. So for my purposes, I would say black hole, the key features are singularity and horizon. The horizon has a radius. In the case of Schwarzschild solution, this radius is the famous Schwarzschild radius, which is on the order of a few kilometers for a solar mass black hole. Then it goes directly proportional to the max. So a 10 to the 8 solar mass black hole would be 3 times 10 to the 8 kilometers. Spinning black holes have slightly different sizes for their horizons for a given mass. It's always of this order, GM over C squared. I just wanted to remind you of the classic black hole solutions that we know about. Schwarzschild came up with one parameter black hole solution. That one parameter is the mass. This is the gravitational mass that you would measure if you are at some distance from the black hole. Leisner and Nordstrom very quickly, and I think these were two independent papers, 16 and 18, maybe Vishnu is going to give us a lot more of the history in his talk. They added one more parameter. So they said you can add an electric charge, and I can have a two-parameter family of black hole solutions parameterized by these two numbers, mass and charge. Kerr in 1963 came up with this celebrated solution, the Kerr solution, which includes angular momentum, so a spinning black hole, which now has two parameters, mass and angular momentum J. For an astrophysicist, this is the key solution, because this is the solution that we use when we are trying to model real-life black holes that we see in the sky. 2 years later, Newman added back the charge to the Kerr solution, and now we've got this most general solution, the Kerr-Newman solution, which has got mass, angular momentum, and electric charge. And you look at this and you say, look, okay, I can keep on adding more and more stuff, and I'll get more and more complicated black holes. But in fact, these are the only solutions known. These are, you know, under certain restrictions, asymptotically flat, vacuum, etc., etc. This is it. And in fact, we have the so-called no-hair theorem. And I personally don't know whether it's really a theorem or still a conjecture. There are mathematicians here who probably know this better. But it's something that we all believe. And the theorem basically states that this is it. If you see a black hole, it has to belong to this family of solutions. And at most, you can have three numbers associated with it, M, J, and Q. That's a really powerful statement, because as you can see, we see black holes that are enormously massive, up to 10 to the 10 solar masses, 10 to the 10 times the mass of the sun. And to think that that huge object can finally be not approximated, but exactly described by three numbers is a, you know, it's a really amazing concept. So this is, I think, one of the most amazing results from GR and black hole theory. Namely, the black hole is as simple as it gets. I think of the black hole essentially like an elementary particle. A proton, we say, has got a mass, a charge, and a spin. And that's it, right? For the proton, actually not. People, they talk about quarks and stuff inside the proton. But in fact, the black hole is, this is it. There's a mass, a spin, which, at least in astrophysics, we like to describe. The angular momentum we rescale in this form, A star gm squared over C. So you get rid of all the dimensions. And A star is just a dimensionless number. This is A over M, for those who work with the Kerr metric. So A star is just this dimensionless number that goes from 0 to 1. 0 non-spinning, 1 is maximally spinning black hole. So M, A star, and Q are the three parameters that you could associate with a classical black hole. In astrophysics, we simplify life even better. We throw away the charge. And the reason is, it's very hard to have any object with substantial electric charge on it. By substantial, I mean dynamically important. The reason is, there are too many free charges floating around in the universe. Everything is a plasma, as we know, out there. So if I put a charged object, the first thing it does is it attracts free charges of the opposite sign and shorts itself off. So we expect black holes that we see in astrophysics generally to be uncharged or weakly charged. This is an assumption. I wish we knew how to verify whether or not this is true. But I'm going to operate in this talk on the assumption that this is all there is. Two numbers to describe a black hole, mass and spin. One slide only on classical versus quantum. So I'm only going to talk about classical black holes. And we believe this classical theory, GR, is sufficient to describe all the black holes we study in astrophysics. They are big objects, macroscopic objects. We don't think quantum mechanics should have a big effect there. But we could be wrong, but this is an assumption. Meanwhile, as you all know, GR and quantum mechanics haven't quite made peace with each other yet. People are still trying to figure out the combined theory, string theory, etc., etc. Huge amounts of interesting stuff associated with quantum black holes. And I'm really looking forward to this talk. I think Samir will tell us what happens to a singularity, or maybe what happens to the horizon when you put in quantum mechanics, So let's see what where that is going. But as far as I'm concerned, classical black hole has a real singularity, a real event for us. So these topics will be for later presentations. So let's come to astrophysical black holes. The first thing is you look at the black hole solution and you say, you know, this is too real. This cannot really represent real nature. And even I'm told, Einstein himself was never happy with the idea of a black hole. And then there are many reasons. The horizon itself, the fact that there is this point of no return and no causal connection from inside to outside, that is worrying. The singularity is worse. Because you know, world lines go and end in the singularity and time just stops. There's no continuation. That's all really very, very disturbing for any physicist. Plus, you know, there's the whole information paradox and all this other good stuff that I think we'll hear in later talks. Many reasons to think that black holes, okay, fine from a theoretical point of view, but reality surely must be different. The big surprise is, no, there are black holes. Reality does include black holes, and in fact, it's not a rare object. There are a hell of a lot of black holes all over the universe. We know of at least two kinds of black holes. There are what are called stellar mass black holes, which have masses roughly in this range, 5 to 20 times the mass of the sun. That's the solar mass. And then there is the supermassive black hole, 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 10 solar masses. We have found these. There may be other kinds as well. There may be black holes in between. There's a big search going on, claims and counterclaims. I don't believe we have really got evidence for something in between. People are looking for mini black holes, things that might have formed early in the universe, that might be evaporating now. Hasn't been seen yet, but could well show up one of these days. These two guys we know for sure. I'll show you the kinds of systems where we have seen these black holes. The stellar mass black holes, the best current guess is there are something like 10 to the 7 to 10 to the 8 of these black holes just in our own galaxy. And every galaxy has got this many. It's a huge population. These black holes are formed when very massive stars finish their life. They burn all their fuel, they end, they collapse under their own gravity and make black holes. Now, a small handful of these systems are actually visible. See, most of these black holes, they're sitting by themselves. They're totally dark. There's almost no way that you can find them. But occasionally, one of these big black holes happens to be in a binary with a companion star, and the two guys are going around each other in an orbit. Gas flows from the companion star to form what's called an accretion disk. Because of angular momentum, the gas goes into an orbit, and then it slowly spirals in through viscous interactions until it reaches the very center. Now, in the process of falling from this large radius to the small radius, there's a huge amount of potential energy that's released, and some fraction of that becomes heat and the hot gas radiates. So in fact, these guys produce huge amounts of X-ray luminosity, close to Eddington luminosity in some cases. And X-rays we know how to detect, and so we detect these particular black holes through their accretion disks. The gas, of course, finally goes into the black hole through the horizon. Then you don't see anything. Fortunately for us, before it reaches the horizon, it produces a lot of radiation. We can catch that radiation. And having found that system, we can then go study the black hole and see, you know, say something about it. Sometimes these systems produce what are called relativistic jets. So even while gas is flowing in, some part of it seems to get diverted into these twin beams, which are going with relativistic speed, you know, above, say, 90% of the speed of light in many cases, even 99% in some cases. Huge blobs of energy.